Okay, we talked today about implementation strategies for digital design. The main theme regarding this issue is the fact that, as we have already discussed, we have observed a strong increase in the complexity of digital integrated circuits in the last decades. And the main observation is that the increase in design complexity has been faster than the increase in designer productivity. Okay. So this poses a challenge because it becomes harder and harder to design a complete integrated circuit. So complexity in IC design increases faster than designer productivity. We can measure the complexity in terms of number of transistors per chip. Okay, so we have a simple measure. Of course, if the complexity of chips and the designer productivity would increase at the same time, the same size of the team would be sufficient for the increasing complexity of ICs. Instead, we have a significant difference. In practice, we have an increasing complexity of about 58% per year. And if you look at the improvement of design productivity, it's something like 21% per year, averaged over a few decades. These are numbers from the industry, basically. You see there's a significant gap, and the meaning is that team size increases. It's not uncommon now to have a team of about 1,000 designers for a single complex chip. A complex chip can be, for example, the A8 system on a package of the iPhone, or a major microprocessor, or a major GPU, graphical processing unit. So at the beginning of the CMOS technology, the typical size was 10-12 people. And now we have observed an significant increase, which poses huge problems in also the coordination of the design. We need to discuss this aspect because there are some improvements in the design methodologies that in recent years have allowed to manage this complexity. Because in time we observed the introduction of new design methodologies, which gives, they are called productivity leaps. So bounces of productivity that allow a team to be able to, let's say, design a significantly complex chip, significantly more complex chip without increasing too much the size of the team. What are these productivity leaps? Let me put it here. No. Okay. Lips are related to the introduction of new design methodologies. And as you will see, it is basically a shift from a CQ design to something which is closer to software design. The first of these productivity leaps was in the 70s, and it was the use of the so-called programmable logic arrays. Which basically allows to implement in a simple way combinatorial logic, any combinatorial logic. This was from the 70s. Then in the late 80s, we started to see design with standard cells. Which is, let's say, in some way, if you look at the a software metaphor, okay, it is something like passing from programming in assembler to programming in a very, let's say, a low level language such as C or Fortran. Okay, just you have standard cells which are basically primitive functions that you can use to build a more complex chip. Then we have macro cells, which are even larger logical blocks. Then we have, together with macro cells, also module compilers. We shall see that module compilers are actually software compilers that are able to implement a macro cell with some parametrization. And then we have gate arrays, and then more recently reconfigurable hardware. This part of reconfigurable hardware is related to the so-called FPGA and to the higher level of abstraction in chip design, and is the subject of the lectures that you have with Professor Fanucci and collaborators. But now I want to go into some more detail along these lines and to look into each of these new design methodologies that have provided productivity leaps. So let's look at the generic complex digital chip. Okay, let's look at the generic structure. Complex digital IC. Such as, for example, a microprocessor. Okay, we start from here because actually this part of the course is related to the microprocessor of the smartphone. So there are at least four main parts in a complex digital IC, and the first part is the so-called data path. The data path is the part of the integrated circuits where computations are performed. Therefore, in the data path, we have combinatorial functions, basically, mostly. which means we have logic gates, logic function, logic gates and functions, let's say, in general. And also we have arithmetic functions. The activity in the data path is actually controlled by a so-called control module. That is a finite state machine. Practice, let's say, determines what happens in the chip at any given moment. Of course, a finite state machine, you know this very well, is a sequential circuit. Okay. So computations are performed in the data path. The control module determines what happens in the integrated circuit. And then we have a third important block is the memory module. That has as its main task that of providing data storage. Okay, of course there are several options and several types of memories. So the memory module is not uniform. You can have different types of memories available because there are different things that this memory has to do. For example, we have read-only memory. In which typically the code is written, and we have read-write memory for the data. Okay, this is a rough distinction, not really rigid. Then we have memory with sequential access. Such as, for example, a FIFO pipe. Or we have memory with a random access. Then we have memory with an access from a single port or for multiple ports. And then, of course, we have the different types of memory, the dynamic memory. We have the static memory. And we have the non-volatile memory. And depending on the type of applications, we can have all of them or only some of them. Okay. Then there's a final, very important block, and the more complex the circuit, the more important this part is, it is the interconnect network. The network with all the interconnections between the different parts of the chip, and part of the interconnect network are also the input output blocks, the parts that communicate with the external world. As I was saying, the interconnections are more and more important the larger is the ship, and it's pretty, let's say, intuitive why these things happen, because of course if you have, let's say, n elements in the integrated circuit, you typically have something like n square possible interconnections. Okay, if you imagine to, if we exclude some coefficients just to look at the power, at the exponent. Of course, here we are now imagining of, let's say, making point-to-point communications between all the elements. Of course, this is not the case. We can introduce some buses in order to, let's say, reduce the complexity of the communication. We can introduce some hierarchy. We can introduce also new type of technologies which are well known from the point of view of research, but not really so well widespread in actual products. That is this concept of network on a chip, which means we have all the different blocks in the chip that communicate as if on a network. So they basically use a single interconnections in a way that is similar to a bus, but somewhat closer to what a network such as the Ethernet is on a single chip. So these are all mechanisms to reduce the exponent to the n. But also, if we include all these techniques, the exponent becomes smaller than 2, but still larger than 1. So still it's true that as we increase the size of the chip, the complexity of the interconnections increase. So to reduce the complexity of interconnects, we have buses, we have hierarchy, or we have, network on chip. In the end, we have something closer to n to the gamma, to the power of gamma, where gamma is a number that is still larger than 1, but smaller than 2. Okay. What are the most critical interconnects? Basically, the one that you can imagine: power, distribution, and clock distribution. Why they are the most critical? Because they have to be provided to all parts of the circuits. Are the most critical interconnects. Provided. to all logic gates. We shall see that one of the ways to cope with the complexity of the interconnect is to use software to make semi-automatic placement and routing. So placement of the blocks of the chip on the die and routing, which means, well, let's say, deploying the interconnections. Okay, just to summarize the main building blocks, we have the control module, we have the data path, we have the memory module, and then we have interconnects and I/O input output. And then the type of communications that we have is the following. From the control module, we have communication. This way is okay. From the control module, we have communications with all the other modules, and then we have communication of all the other modules with the interconnects. Okay, this is both ways. Of course, the data path and the memory module talk through the interconnect to the interconnection system. Okay, and then here we have, in this direction, we have the external world. But there are differences in how these modules are designed, because indeed we have this type of situation. The memory module is very regular, because once we have decided what are the different pieces, the different types of memory we need, and what is the size of each block of memory, basically the structure is, of course, very regular, because we have big arrays, right? So also the structure on silicon is extremely regular. The control module is somewhat regular as a structure, because there are, let's say, recurring rules in how to build a control module and how to build this type of finite state machine. So more or less in all processors, they resemble each other. The interconnects and the I/O is also very regular, and you should know that, as I told you before, is pretty automatic, in the sense that the interconnections can be, for the most part, done automatically by software, and the I/O ports are more or less codified, belong to a given library of the CMOS technology foundry, so it's all done. This part is, the data path is instead basically ad hoc. So this is the part that differs the most from microprocessor to microprocessor or from complex chip to complex chip, and it's the part that also from the point of view of designer takes the most time. Okay. Now we have to make a general consideration regarding flexibility of design. And efficiency. So, what do we mean by flexibility? Flexibility means two things basically. One is having reusable design that can be used again in other applications. So you design something once, a block, and then you reuse it in other applications. This would make the design actually flexible. So reusable, design, for other applications. Of course, this is an advantage because it can reduce the cost of designing a complete chip. What you have in practice is that when you design a chip, you have some parts that are already available from previous designs, and so you need to put less, let's say, person hours in designing the whole chip. The other part, which still belongs to flexibility, is the fact that you can have, let's say, a generic hardware with a firmware that is upgradable. Okay. So the firmware, of course, is the part of the software that is closer to the hardware design. Okay. Of course, this would add in flexibility because you can change the design, modify the operation of the chip without touching the hardware, which means without going back to the foundry, but doing it in your lab, close to the place where you use the hardware. So these are two strong advantages, but the important thing to keep in mind is that they have a cost, because they typically imply three types of cost: a loss of performance, and the reason for the loss of performance is that adding reusability and programmability basically introduces a large overhead. So you have, if you look at the silicon area, you have large parts of the silicon area that are used to ensure programmability and reusability. This is what we call overhead. They are not doing any real functions. They only serve to reusability. You have also an increase of complexity for the same reason, because there is this large overhead. There is also an additional reason for the loss of performance, and it is the fact that, for example, if you have a firmware on the integrated circuit, you typically have to decode the instruction before acting, and therefore the coding, of course, decreases the performance. You need more time to perform an operation if you first have to decode the instruction. Okay? Instruction decoding requires time. In the end, these two things also add up to an increase in energy consumption. Increase in energy consumption per function. So if you fix the function, the energy consumption is larger if you have reusability or if you have programmability. Of course, what is the other option? The other option is to have everything hardwired. Everything hardwired, which means that if you need to make a change, you need to go to manufacturing again. Because everything is fixed at the manufacturing phase. And this is typically the main trade-off when we have to start to consider the design of a complete chip. So the more flexibility, the higher the cost in terms of performance and in energy and in complexity. Of course, it depends on different aspects, and in particular, as we'll see in a minute, it also depends on the scale of the number of integrated circuits that you have to fabricate. But we are going back to this issue soon. I want to spend a few words on this aspect that I mentioned before, the fact that flexibility means increasing power consumption, because this is not obvious. Before I discuss this issue, of course, I think you have grasped the fact that this is very similar to the same type of considerations that you have when you discuss software. Okay, when you work with languages at a higher level of abstraction, of course, you have more flexibility. You can easily change hardware, but while keeping the code similar, but you of course lose in performance, and of course also in the case of software, you also lose in energy consumption. Okay, so the considerations are very similar and more or less for the same reasons. Regarding this aspect of energy consumption, there is a way of measuring energy efficiency for a chip, which is looking at this metric, MOPS per milliwatt. So, mega operation per second per milliwatt. So, this is a ratio of operation per energy. The higher the number, the more energy efficient. Now, just if we look at the orders of magnitude, if you have custom hardware, so hardware that cannot be modified, everything hardwired, as I said before, just a circuit specific for doing that particular computation, you typically have an order of magnitude of mega operation per second per milliwatt of 10 to the second power. Okay. If you use configurable logic, such as, for example, a programmable logic array. You have seen programmable logic arrays in the electronics course? You have not? Okay, we shall look at it today. Just en passant, but just to have an idea. So these configurable logic configurable logic chips are chips in which you have generic logic functions that you can customize for your particular application, and the customization can be done on your place, not at the manufacturing place. In that case, you already lose one order of magnitude in energy efficiency. You go to 10 order of 10 mega operation per second per milliwatt. Then there is another possibility, that is to have an application specific microprocessor. Application-specific microprocessor. For example, if you have to deal with graphics, you use a GPU for doing the calculation. There is something that you can program, so it's very flexible, but it's still, let's say, somewhat specific to the type of operation that you need to do, because it's a CPU dedicated to graphic processing, for example. And in any case, you go to 1. So it's for example, you lose one order of magnitude if you use a GPU instead of a specific video coder or encoder for the operation. And then finally, if you use a generic microprocessor, you lose another order of magnitude. So in this direction, you're going in increasing flexibility. And in this direction, you go in the sense of increasing energy efficiency. I want to stress, to highlight these numbers, because, I mean, from a qualitative point of view, it's pretty obvious, of course. But from a quantitative point of view, it's not obvious. Typically, from custom hardware to a generic microprocessor for doing the same operation, you have 3 orders of magnitude in terms of energy efficiency, which is a lot, of course, especially for the case of mobile devices, in which you really need to improve the battery lifetime as much as possible. Okay, there is another consideration that I just mentioned before that is related to cost. Let's try to be more quantitative. If we look at the cost of an integrated circuit, typically we have 2 types of cost. We have the so-called recurring expenses, and we have the non-recurring expenses. And of course, the cost is given by the sum of the two. The recurring expenses are the so-called also variable costs. This is something that, of course, is not specific to integrated circuit. It is very generic to any, let's say, industrial production of an item. But since we probably do not deal with those things, it's good to fix the concept here. And then we have the non-recurring expenses, which are also called fixed costs. So what's the difference between the two? Of course, the variable costs are essentially proportional to the number of items. So proportional to the volume of sales that you have of the products. Proportional to the sales volume. Okay, the fixed costs are again independent of the sales volume. So are the costs that you have, even if you need to, let's say, manufacture just one chip. Okay, if you then make this consideration, the total cost of one chip is, of course, the variable cost per chip, which is also called the marginal cost. So the cost of fabricating one more chip, okay, the n plus one chip, plus the fixed cost divided by the number of chips. Let's say number of chips. Which is also the sales volume, right? This is easy, and of course, I mean, if you have a large sales volume, the most important part is given by the variable costs. If you have very small sales volume, the most important factor is the fixed cost, and then in the middle. Now let's discuss the different items separately. The non-recurring costs, the fixed costs, NRE. Let me write it again. So in that case, the fixed costs are basically represented by the time and the person months required for the design. Then we also have the production equipment, related to the specific chip, because for example the mask set is very specific for the chip. The mask set is the set of masks that are required for the CMOS fabrication process. They are not generic, okay? And I wanted to add this part because even if you say, okay, I want to design this chip on my free time, so I don't need to put the cost of the person months, but still you have to, let's say, fabricate the specific masks for your chip, and those are a fixed cost. And you should consider now that for a very advanced process, the complete set of masks costs a few million dollars. In terms of dollars, a few millions. So it's not a cheap item for an advanced technology. Okay, the variable costs are more complex actually to define, because there are a couple of factors that enter into the consideration. Basically, you need to put at least three things together. One is the cost of the die. So the piece of silicon, the die is the piece of silicon already fabricated with a chip on it. Plus, you need to add the cost of die test. And it is not negligible, so it's important to add it. And then you need to add the cost of packaging. To make the sum of these three things, especially for the cheaper integrated circuits, the cost of packaging can be significant as a percentage. And then the very important thing is that you have to divide this sum by the final test yield. The yield of the final test. What is the yield? Is the percentage of chips that are working properly. The other ones, you typically throw them away. Let's say good chips. And this factor is important because you cannot assume 100% yield. The yield can go from something like 90% to 60%, and even lower in realistic case, not in very particular cases. In realistic case, you can have a yield that is not really good, and you have to throw away a lot of chips. Okay. These costs are pretty easy to consider. Let's focus a bit on the cost of the die. Because the cost of the die is given by a simple expression, is essentially the cost of the wafer, the completely fabricated wafer, because the single unit in a fab is the wafer. We have already discussed this aspect. All the chips are fabricating a wafer at a time, and then only at the end the wafer is cut into pieces, and then you have the single chips. So you have at the fab, you have the cost per wafer. Then in order to obtain the cost of the die, you need to divide the cost of the wafer for the number of die that you have on a single wafer. So you have here the number of dies per wafer. And then also here you have to consider the yield of the die. So actually, I have to correct myself in the sense that, okay, let me just define the die yield. The die yield is the percentage of good dies. So the final test yield is the percentage of dies that were good, but then after packaging bad, that you have basically broken during the packaging. So When I said I need to correct myself, when I said before that the yield can be also pretty poor, I was referring to the die yield. The die yield can go even to very low numbers, low 60-70%. Below that, it would be a significant problem. The final test yield is typically not bad. It's close to one. Okay. The number of dies per wafer is a number that if you make a calculation and if you consider, for example, 12-inch wafer is a wafer with a diameter of 12-inch. 12-inch are 30 centimeters. Then if you consider that the area of a die can be, let's say, at most 2 centimeters square, then if you do the calculation, you see that you have a few hundred dies per wafer. The calculation is pretty easy, of course. You need just to compute the area of the of the circle, because more or less that would be okay. Then, now, all these factors can be typically known from the fab. One thing that is somewhat critical is this die yield. Let us discuss this issue in some more detail. What's the problem with die yield? The problem is that when you do the fabrication of a complete wafer, you can have some errors. Simple errors can be a dust particle, because even if you are in a clean room, then you still can have some dust, and then a dust particle can completely ruin a chip. Or you can have some error in the processing. And the problem with all the errors is that the larger is the die, the higher is the probability of having some error in it. So you have to take into account that the higher the area of the die, the lower the yield. And from some considerations, there is a formula that is typically used in these cases. It's an empirical formula, so must be tuned for each foundry, that says something like this. The die yield is something close to 1 plus the number of defects per die, average number of defects per die. Let me write it directly. The number of defects per die is typically the number of defects per unit area times the die area. So this product would be the number of defects per die, average, on average, divided by a factor which is called alpha to the power of 1 over alpha. To the power of minus alpha. And empirically, for a modern CMOS process, alpha is about 3. So qualitatively, if you take the yield as a function of the area, you have something like this. This is 1, you typically have something like this. It goes pretty low. The higher the area, the lower the yield. Just to make a, just to give some numeric example, I made some simple calculations. If you have, let's make a numerical example. If you have on average one defect per centimeter square, on average, that is not bad. That would be good for a modern CMOS process. Then you can say, if the area of the die is 2.5 square centimeters, and I make the calculation, I obtain a yield which is very, very poor, and is 16.2%. So 1 in 6 chips is good. Now, this is the reason why in practice we do not have integrated circuits that are larger than 2 centimeters square, because already the yield would be extremely poor. Now, one can reduce the number of defects per centimeter square, but the order of 1 is the practical order of magnitude. Okay, but things change pretty quickly if you reduce the area, because just by making a simple calculation, if we have a diarrhea of 0.25 centimeter square, which is not bad, basically is a square half centimeter by half centimeter, so it's not really small as a chip, and I substitute in the expression above here, we have a yield of about 78%. So it's almost 4 in 5. If the diarrhea is 1 millimeter squared, so 0.01 centimeter squared, which is, for example, typical for the designs that we do here, typically do very small chips, because of course we do not have a team of 1,000 designers, so one typically makes an interesting building block and then checks the operation. Well, in that case the yield is close to 99%. So you can see this is something that goes down pretty dramatically, and it's the reason why in practice, in time, you have not observed a large increase of diarrhea, because the yield drops steeply. Okay, let's make a break.